right, so let us begin. We're limited on time, but we're on chapter 3 of The Cross and Its Shadow by Stephen N. Haskell. And I will begin. And once again, oh yeah, go ahead, Sister Lisa, please.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this wonderful day of being giving us. Help us to be faithful unto you and to understand what you want to tell us through this book. May we be like Bereans to study your word and to be more like you. I pray you for all the prior subjects we've been telling each other. Help us to stay faithful to you, bring to you back the young people which have been taken by the devil, and every person which is tormented. Help them to be faithful to you. And direct our minds as we're going to study this, your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Okay. So then let us begin. And once again, let us all participate. And if you find anything as you are reading your page, because we're all reading a page, it's okay to pause and analyze something. Something has caught your attention and you want to expound on it, or you want to look into it, remember the marginal references as well. We can look them up
here, for example, with 38, but Saul has got on every page, so if you want to know what it is, it's going to give you the reference.
Yeah, I could look up the reference
on the bottom of
here
the
at
page.
The bottom of the page.
We don't have it here.
No, we don't have it.
It tells you that there's a reference, but it gives it to me here. So if you want to know what the reference is, just let me know, stop, and I can look. We can look it up. Okay?
Okay.
All right, so let us begin. Mm-hmm. History of the sanctuary. The history of the typical service of which the earthly tabernacle was a visible representation began at the gate of the Garden of Eden, where our first parents brought their offerings and presented them before the Lord. Abel showed his faith in the promised Savior by bringing an animal. He not only presented the shed blood of the sacrifice, but he also presented the fat to the Lord, showing faith in the Savior and willingness to put away his sin. Before the people of God went into Egypt, their worship was simple. The patriarchs lived near the Lord and did not need many forms or ceremonies to teach them the one grand truth that sin could be atoned for only by the death of one who was sinless. They needed only a rough altar and an innocent lamb to connect their faith with the infinite sin bearer. So, according to what we just read, when did the history of the typical service begin?
Eden.
Garden.
It was in the Garden of Eden.
At the gate. Yeah.
Right? We saw that this was after sin.
Yeah.
They would go to the gate of Eden and there present the sacrifice, which was a
blood.
Symbol of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, the Lamb of God, which was slain from the foundation of the world.
Where's that found, sister?
Revelation.
Revelation?
Yeah.
13. Let's look it up. Revelation 13. If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, verse 8.
Would you like to read it for us?
Of course.
Go ahead.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, and whose name are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world.
Amen. So we can see that. We can prove things through the Bible. The Bible gives us the answers as well. That's what our pioneers taught, and this is what we believe as well.
Amen. Okay. Tell us when the page is ending, because it's not the same for us.
Yeah, that's my page. Go ahead.
Okay. As the patriarchs journeyed from place to place, they set up their altars and offered their sacrifices, and God drew near to them, often showing his acceptance of their offerings by sending fire from heaven to consume the sacrifices. Of all the sacrifices recorded in the book of Genesis, none comes so near the great antitypical offering as the one required of Abraham when God called him to offer his only son. The test of faith was not simply in the fact that Isaac was his only legitimate son, but Abraham understood that through Isaac's posterity, the long-promised Messiah was to come. And in offering Isaac, Abraham was cutting off his only hope of salvation as well as that of the world. But his faith wavered not. He believed that the same God who had performed a miracle in giving him a son could bring that son from the dead to fulfill the promise that he had made. The Lord chose the exact spot for the offering of Isaac. He said to Abraham, "Get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of." As Abraham and Isaac went on that memorable journey, they were directed by the Lord to Mount Moriah. And when they came to the place, Abraham built an altar and bound Isaac upon it, ready to sacrifice him. But the Lord stayed his hand. The spot where such loyalty to God was shown was ever afterward honored by the Lord. But the devil, as well as the Lord, watched over this place. He knew it was sacred to Jehovah, because there God had tested the faith of the man he honored by calling him his friend. For more than 400 years after the children of Israel entered the Promised Land, Satan held this place. It was a stronghold of the enemy in the midst of Israel.
Right there. Okay, so what do we get from what you just read?
The best sacrifice, the best representation of the sacrifice was Isaac's sacrifice, because it was really representing God and his son, and that it was in a specific place. It was design of God.
So it was through Abraham's seed, which was Isaac, his promised seed, that we are able to see whom?
Jesus.
Jesus Christ,
yeah.
Right? Because just like Abraham's seed, Isaac, was his only begotten. He was his only son. So, also, God's son, Jesus Christ, his only son, came to offer himself to us. So we could see the perfect representation in Isaac.
Amen.
You know, and I believe it was this object lesson that he was giving Abraham so that he can understand the character
of God.
How loving. To give his only son. And in response, Abraham was able to do the same. He was able to offer up his best, which was his only son. Right? Any other comments? No? Okay, sister.
It was.
She had one more sentence. Oh, is it different than yours?
Yeah, it's different. I'm closing.
The same paragraph. Okay.
Go ahead.
But it was final.
But it was finally captured by David, who made it the capital of his kingdom. Afterward, Jerusalem was called the City of David. The threshing floor of Ornan, the
Jebusite,
where the angel of the Lord appeared to David, was on his same spot. The prophet told David to erect an altar on the threshing floor, and there David made a special consecration to the Lord. A few years later, the temple, which was erected without sound of hammer, occupied this same plot of land. God had conquered, and he designed the place should ever be hallowed by his presence. But his people were unfaithful, and when the Lord of Light came to his own temple, he was despised and crucified, and the holy city and the site of the sacred temple passed into the hands of the Gentiles. Continue. Satan is guarding this spot vigilantly at the present time, intending never again to relinquish his hold upon it. But the time is coming when, in spite of Satan and all his host, the same Savior who was rejected in his own temple shall place his feet upon the Mount of Olives, and the entire site of an old Jerusalem will be purified. Then the new Jerusalem will come down from heaven and rest upon that spot made sacred by the consecration of God's chosen people. God's glorious heavenly temple will be upon Mount Zion, Moriah, never more to fall into the hands of the enemy. God says, I will set my sanctuary in the midst of them forevermore.
Right there. All right, so what do we get from your page?
A lot.
A whole lot, right?
It shows the difference. This spot of place where Isaac was offered in sacrifice is always God's place. Even in the New Jerusalem, it's where it's going to be.
So where Isaac was going to be offered, this is where God's going to set his sanctuary. Wow, that's powerful. That's powerful.
And it says it will be on Mount Zion.
Mount Zion or Moriah.
Yeah.
All right.
So that's where the New Jerusalem is going to be set.
Yeah. It's going
that's
to
crazy that
the
it has
mountains.
An exact spot.
Yeah.
So we could go there today.
It says
to visit it to see where it will be.
That's right.
That's amazing. That's right. It's so real.
The Mount of Olives, it says that he's going to split the Mount of Olives. It's going to be a giant plain.
Mm.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead. Did you have something to say?
No.
Okay. You're going to read?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
If anybody else.
It's okay.
Having briefly outlined the subject from Eden lost to Eden restored, we will go back to the time Israel came out of Egypt. Subjected to a life of incessant toil and surrounded by heathen darkness, the children of Israel lost sight of the significance of their simple sacrifices. On account of their servitude, they were deprived of the privileges enjoyed by the ancient patriarchs, of spending much time communing with God, and they drifted very near to Egyptian idolatry. When God brought them out of Egypt, he proclaimed his law from Sinai, and then gave them the same system of worship the patriarchs had followed. But he had to deal with them as with children, because they could not grasp the truths without the simple illustrations. God gave them the system of worship that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had followed, but in kindergarten form, just as we would use the kindergarten methods to teach children lessons which adults can easily comprehend.
What means kindergarten?
Kindergarten is like
the very beginning grade of school.
Okay. Yeah.
Before you even get to first grade, there's kindergarten preparation for first grade.
For grade school, yeah.
Okay.
They had drifted so far away that they could not comprehend how God could live with them, being invisible. So God said, let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them. The pillar of cloud above the tabernacle and God's visible presence manifested within helped the Israelites more easily to comprehend the real abiding presence of the Lord within them, with them. This sanctuary was a shadow or model of the heavenly sanctuary, and the service was so planned by the Lord that all the work was a type or representation of the work the Son of God would do on earth and in heaven for the redemption of the lost race. It was the most wonderful object lesson ever given to mankind.
Right there. Okay, so what do we learn from your page, Kayla?
That the sanctuary that was made by man's hand was the most wonderful object lesson for what is the work in heaven, what's going to take place. And God uses object lessons to teach our dull minds that have been, dulled by years and years and thousands of years of sin, to teach us even today the lessons he would have us to learn. And he did the same thing for them because their minds were dulled through all the things that the Egyptians were trying to brainwash them with.
Did you have something to say?
Yeah, I want to say something that they had forgotten the Sabbath. And so by the sanctuary, God says, I will dwell with you. He's going to learn them everything back.
So he's going to restore, right? He's going to restore. Mm-hmm. Now keep that in mind.
And it's from Eden destroyed to Eden restored. And even in other places, Ellen White talks about that the Garden of Eden will be in the new earth.
Yeah, it's the same.
What's another word for object lesson?
Parables.
Parable.
Analogies.
Analogy.
Types.
Parables.
Parables. One more. Figures.
Figures.
Okay, so this was a figure. Mm-hmm. So what God showed or Jesus showed to Moses was a figure. What was that figure? Let's go to Exodus 25:8. Let's take a look at this real quick.
That they make me sanctuary that I may dwell in.
Amen.
25:8.
It was a system of worship.
I just quoted it by heart.
Well, let's read verse 9 as well. Verse 8 and 9.
And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them, according to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it.
Okay. So, the purpose of the sanctuary was why?
That God may dwell with them.
So that he may dwell with them, okay? But then we see in verse 9 that God is doing what? He says, according to all that I
show thee.
So, this was a vision. Mm-hmm. Right here, we see that Moses is in vision. And what's another word for vision?
He envisioned what it looked like.
Vision. What's this?
Visions that Daniel
prophecy.
John
prophecy. That's right. That's prophecy. So the sanctuary is actually prophecy.
Yeah, because it prophesies the coming of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And a temple. Like, you know, let them make me a sanctuary. Well, the sanctuary was a temple, which is the representation of the temple of in heaven. And then when there was no more sanctuary because Christ died and was the lamb slain from the foundation of the earth, well, when that happened, there had to be another representation. So then Paul uses our body as an example, because our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So we must do the same thing. We must keep it, healthy and clean, and only spiritually fed for us to have Christ living inside of us, that he may dwell within us.
Amen.
By the way, when it says, according to the pattern I showed you, what is according to the pattern is the image. But the pattern is the real thing.
That's right.
And some people may say that the heavenly sanctuary is not true, but God, Jesus came back in heaven in a human flesh. So he has to be in a physical place.
That's right.
If he's human.
That's right. If Jesus came to make himself a man, literal, so that means that the sanctuary is also literal.
Amen.
It's a literal place. Although we can't see it, we know it's there.
Amen.
Because Jesus Christ came as a fulfillment of that prophecy, right? Now, let me...
Not that much, because we try to find arguments about it,
exactly.
Because God tells us quite simply.
Exactly. We see all of these things are actually tied to the sanctuary.
Yeah.
And I'm going to point something out about that even in our message. Did you have something to say?
If for people who say that... prophecies, where's Jesus in prophecies, like the sanctuary itself is a prophecy. He's definitely there.
Just like
this. So you can't even say that.
Exactly. Now go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and we're going to look at verse 11. Okay. Tara, can you read that for us when you find it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Now all these things happened unto them for end samples, for they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come.
Now I notice you're using your device. Does it have a marginal reference there?
No.
Okay.
My Bible.
Who wants to give us the marginal reference for end samples? What does that mean?
Means
example.
Or types.
Types. And once again, what's a type?
It's a
figure. It's prophecy. So everything that took place with them would take place also in our time, right?
It's a prophecy.
Because it's a prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
It's a prophecy. So let me ask you, here we have the 1850 chart. Do we see the sanctuary in here?
Yes.
Right over here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's interesting that all of these things are actually linked to the sanctuary.
Oh, well, the lines come here.
Didn't you know that?
Oh, yeah.
In regards to the 25:20, doesn't it have to do with the sanctuary?
Mm-hmm. By the way, all the lines, this line
exactly
comes to here.
All of these things take us to the sanctuary.
Amen.
So this in itself is the sanctuary message.
Yeah.
See?
The sanctuary is one of our most...
types, figures...
fundamental.
Yeah, it's our foundation.
This is our foundation.
Amen.
This is why we'll find certain statements in Ellen White's writings where she'll say the sanctuary is the foundation of our faith. Because this is everything that it has to do with. The 25:20, the 2300, all of these things have to do with the sanctuary service. And I mean, we could even look into it, Leviticus 26. Let's go there real quick, because a lot of people don't see this, and I think that it's very important that we should have this in our mind very clearly. It says in plain terms that this indeed has to do with the sanctuary. Let's go to Leviticus 26, and let me look at the verse here. Leviticus 26, verse 2. Mm-hmm. Someone like to read that for us?
Leviticus 26, verse 2 says, "Ye shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord."
Okay, so do we see the sanctuary tied with Leviticus 26?
Yeah.
So this was the blessing. If they were to keep the covenant, then God would... they would also have to reverence the sanctuary, right? And this was tied in with his name. So,
and then if we do that, he'll give us rain in due season. If
amen.
We read a
as
little
we
further,
as
yeah,
we continue
verse
reading.
Four.
Verse
amen.
Four.
But we should continue with this because we only have a few more minutes.
That's fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Who is next?
Me.
Oh, no, we ended up... where did we stop? Did we read the whole thing?
The sanctuary was completed.
Yeah.
Okay, so
here,
we're over
so
here.
Yeah.
Okay, so
sure.
Go ahead, Tara.
The sanctuary was completed while the Israelites were encamped at Sinai. And during their 40 years wanderings in the wilderness, they carried it with them. When they reached the promised land, it was set up in Gilgal for a few years, and then removed to Shiloh, where it remained for many years. When David was fleeing from Saul, the tabernacle was in Nob. For there the priests set the showbread before the Lord each Sabbath day. It was next set up in the high place at Gibeon. The tabernacle remained in Gibeon until removed by Solomon to Jerusalem.
Josephus
tells us that Solomon had the tabernacle which Moses had pitched, and all the vessels that were for administration to the sacrifice of God removed to the temple. David desired to build a house for God, but on account of his many wars, the Lord directed that his son should build the house. When Solomon was established on his throne, he erected a magnificent structure and dedicated it to the Lord. God showed his acceptance by his glory filling the temple. Solomon did not plan the temple himself. God revealed the plan to David as he had that of the tabernacle to Moses.
That's all, right?
You could keep reading a little bit more.
David was not to see it built, but when he delivered the plan for the building to Solomon, he said, "The Lord make me understand in writing by his hand upon me, even all the works of this pattern."
Right there. Okay. So, what do you get from this page, Tara?
Well, it's kind of interesting that David wasn't allowed to build the temple. Even though he's a man after God's own heart, he still, that was reserved for his son. Because Solomon was, what, peaceful? And he had to, I think they said he had, like, bloody hands or something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He had shed too much blood. And this is why God said that Solomon would erect the temple.
But because of all the wars, the land was peaceful for his son Solomon to reign for 40 years.
It's necessary.
Right. Right, and then another thing that we also see is that just like Moses was given a pattern, right? Do we not see the same thing in the erection of this sanctuary? He was also given a pattern. And it's very interesting that it was given to the father, right? David. And he passed it on to whom?
His son.
Now that's very important, right? Mm-hmm. Are we to respect those that are were before us? Yes. Our forefathers, mm-hmm. our pioneers that established this truth?
Amen.
Yes.
I like very much this verse which is quoted. The Lord made me to understand in writing by His hand upon me, even all the works of His pattern.
Amen. So His hand was in it, right?
Yeah, it was His writing hand. Upon him. So it's like if it was writing His seal on David, was He was erecting the temple.
Yes. Exactly.
This is a wonderful verse to study.
Amen.
I think it was interesting when they were wandering in the wilderness for 40 years, they took the tabernacle with them.
Yes. So they would carry it around.
So it wasn't just something that they can go away from. It was like a part of...
It was a part of their everyday life. Right. It wasn't something like, oh, okay, let's put this away.
Out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah, no. This was a living experience in their daily lives.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Every day, and they were very organized about everything they did. You know, it wasn't just, you know, careless at all. It was very organized, and they all had to be dedicated to that service. And so likewise, we today, as we handle these things, we have to take this seriously.
Amen.
You know, but anyhow, let's continue. I guess I would be next, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The history of Solomon's temple is really a history of the religious experience of the children of Israel. When they departed from the Lord, the temple was neglected and sometimes even suffered violence. It was pillaged by Shishak, king of Egypt, at the instigation of Jehoiada. It was repaired by Jehoash, who himself
afterward
robbed it of its treasures to propitiate the Syrians. Ahaz, a little later, not only spoiled it for its treasures, but also defiled its holy precincts. Under the reign of a good king, Hezekiah, the temple was purified and its worship restored. But even Hezekiah stripped it of its treasures to proclaim a treaty with the Assyrians. Again, it was polluted by idolatrous worship of Manasseh. The good king Josiah, when but a youth of 18, repaired and purified the temple and again restored its worship. Finally, on account of the unfaithfulness of the chosen people of God, the holy temple was burned to the ground and its treasures carried to Babylon. Okay, so here we see that there is a history of apostasy, reform, you know, throughout all that time. And so, as a result, that sanctuary was burned to the ground. Why?
They were unfaithful.
They were unfaithful. But where were they warned about this?
In the beginning. In the
Leviticus.
Yeah. 7 times.
26. The 7 times. Right?
Because they had not given rest unto the land.
Exactly. Because of their iniquities. Because of the polluted... they polluted the sanctuary. You know, and they were told to reverence the sanctuary, keep it holy. You know, but since they didn't, we see that destruction came as a sure result of their apostasy, which is clearly shown to us in Leviticus 26.
It's time.
Oh. We just have to finish. Yeah,
we can finish.
We just have 2 pages left.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I think so.
It was merely...
I think we should finish, because I don't know about you, but I have to Skype some people.
You can leave if you want.
I don't want to miss.
then we're almost done.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Okay, well, let's just read it then without the commentary, if we could.
That's kind of hard. But we'll do our best. We'll finish. Okay? Yeah. We're almost done.
Go ahead. It was nearly 7 years before the rebuilding of the temple by Zerubbabel was completed and the house dedicated with great rejoicing. Herod spent 46 years in repairing Zerubbabel's temple until in the days of Christ it was a magnificent structure. God's presence abode with his people in the dwelling places they prepared for him. From the time of the tabernacle was erected in the wilderness all the way down through the history of their spiritual wanderings until that memorable day when the types celebrated for 4,000 years met their antitype on the cross of Calvary. Then, with a great noise, the glorious veil of Herod's magnificent building was rent from the top to the bottom as the Lord departed forever from his temple. Previous to this, the services were directed of God. Henceforth, they were but a hollow mockery, for God had left the sanctuary. The temple remained standing until 70 AD, when it was destroyed by the Romans. Today, the sacred spot is covered by a Mohammedan mosque. The epistle to the Hebrews shows that the leading apostles clearly taught the antitypical fulfillment of the types and shadows celebrated for so many years. It should not be forgotten that the gift of the spirit of prophecy and the Sabbath of the Lord were always connected with the sanctuary service. We have no reason to doubt that during the holy history of the Christian Church, the subject of the sanctuary and the antitypical work of Christ in heaven was clearly understood by the Christians. But when the Bible was taken from them, when the Sabbath of the Lord was hidden, and the voice of the Spirit of prophecy was no longer heard, directing the Church, then they lost sight of the beautiful antitypical work represented by the ancient sanctuary sacrifice.
Okay, right there. All right, so just quickly, what did you get?
As it says, the sanctuary is connected with Sabbath and the spirit of prophecy. So, as in the Middle Age, the Dark Ages, the Sabbath was forsaken and the spirit of prophecy.
During
the sanctuary was forsaken.
That's right.
But when in 1844 they discovered the sanctuary.
That's right.
Then they discovered the Sabbath and the spirit of prophecy.
Amen.
It's
Amen.
Wonderful.
Praise the Lord. Okay. I think that's the main point that we get from there. Go ahead, sister.
But the time arrived for the opening of the great judgment in heaven when the Father and the Son with their
retinue
of holy angels. Retinue of holy angels passed in state into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. No earthly pageant could ever compare with that majestic
cortege.
God designed that it should be recognized on earth, and he caused a message to be proclaimed to the inhabitants of the earth, directing their attention to the moments of the movements of the Son of God. This is known as the first angel's message of Revelation 14, 6, and 7. A large company accepted the message and their attention was centered on the Savior, but they did not understand the antitypical work of the sanctuary, and hence they expected the Savior to come to the earth. Instead of coming to the earth, however, he went into the second apartment of the heavenly sanctuary to take up the work of the judgment. Want me to continue?
Yeah, just finish it.
This company who had been gathered out by the message of the first angel loved their Lord, and in their longing desire to find why he had not come to the earth, they drew so near to him that he, in answer to their earnest prayers, directed their attention to the heavenly sanctuary. There they saw the ark of God's testament containing his holy law, and they acknowledged its claims upon them, and began to keep holy the Sabbath of the Lord. The sanctuary service, the Sabbath, and the spirit of prophecy were ever united in olden times, and when light from the antitypical sanctuary service came to the people of God, he gave them the spirit of prophecy again, to reveal to them the solemn truths in regards to Christ's ministry in heaven, which otherwise they would not have comprehended. That's what you were talking about.
Exactly. So, do you have any comments?
was basically what the order in which God gave them these things.
Okay, so once again, the sanctuary, and I think I mentioned it as well, the sanctuary connected to the prophecies, right?
Yeah.
And the foundation of our faith. Mm-hmm. They all go hand in hand. One thing I just want to mention quickly before we do finish, and we'll have to skip the summary here. It mentioned the mosque in the land of Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Remember that?
Yeah.
Now, have you ever thought about how was it that that mosque ended up being there? What happened? It's right here on the charts. For a second. Whoa. Mm-hmm. That's how it happened. That's the history. They took over all of that land.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Remember? The children of the East came and they were attacking Rome. And in their efforts of doing all that, they took over Jerusalem as well. So, anyhow, if there's no other comments, we can finish with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so ever thankful for your wonderful truths that are found in Holy Writ. The prophecies that point to Jesus Christ, our great Redeemer, that came at the time appointed to lay down his life for each and every one of us and the whole world. We are so thankful for the privilege and honor that you have given us as a people to understand these things and study these things out for ourselves, that we might not be deceived, dear Father. We pray that you would continue to be with us throughout this day. Please answer the prayers that we have set forth in regards to Brother Enoch's petition and Sister Elisa as well. Please answer them according to your will. And we are thankful for listening to us at this time and for answering them according to your purpose. Please continue to be with us throughout this day in our efforts in getting closer to you and your truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.